Hey, hey, guys, welcome to Catapult. Well, y'all looking good tonight, man. You ready to go? You ready to go? Have you come hungry for the Word of God? Have you come hungry to worship tonight? We've got a great night planned for us. Boy, y'all ugly. Man, I'm telling you, y'all ugly. No, y'all, you look good. You look good. You look good. Y'all look good. So, hey, if you're here tonight and you don't want to be in the shot of Facebook, we welcome our Facebook friends with us, as we've offended everybody. But if you don't want to be in the Facebook shot, then sit over here to your right, my left, and that'll take care of the stuff. And if you want to go out, if you'll exit along the sides here, that'll take care of you as well. So, hey, I know we got one guy, brand new, right off the ship, right off the truck. Where is he? Joey, there he is. Joey. Okay, welcome, man. We're glad you're here. There's going to be some awesome things that happen in you. Man, it's going to be unbelievable what God's going to do in your heart, and we're so thankful to take this journey with you. So welcome everybody tonight. We have friends of Brianna here tonight, and Stacia and Andrew. We're so thankful to have them with us tonight. And so, as you know, Pastor Adam will be bringing the word. So guys, let's just come on in. And I know we don't know these guys, but we have a kindred spirit. We've already been talking to these guys. They love the Lord. And they've just come here to honor him, man. And that's what we want to do, right? So this is our brother and our sisters here on this platform tonight. And let's just get in here with them, man, and worship the King and raise him up. Can you stand with me now as we pray? Father, I'm grateful tonight for this opportunity just to stand before the King. And God, I want, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, God. And God, just show us any unclean thing in us, Lord. And as we worship, may we release that to you. Ask you to forgive us. Confess that. And you said you would forgive us, God, and put us in right standing. So tonight we're thankful that we've got an altar that we can come to and that we can get forgiveness. And then we can flow in worship to the King. In Jesus' name. And all the people say, amen. Amen.
Well, we are really excited to be here tonight. And what I really want you to do during this moment is just worship wholeheartedly. It doesn't matter what people are doing around you. It doesn't matter what you look like while you're doing it. We want you to face plant at the feet of Jesus in this moment. That's what this is. That is what worship is. We're coming into the presence of the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, would you just fill this place? Every nook and cranny, every single part, Lord, would you fill us up and strengthen us in ways that we just do not know anything about. That when we leave here tonight, we feel an energy and a presence, Lord, that only comes from you. And right now, I just pray that these voices would be lifted straight to your ears in just love and pureness and the heart in which it comes from, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for this moment. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this floor that we are standing on in this holy place. This is holy grounds. Thank you, Lord.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes I am. Free at last, he has ransomed me, his grace runs deep. While I was a slave to sin, Jesus died for me. Sing it! Jesus died for me. Who the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God, yes I am. In my Father's house, there's a place. I'm a child of God, there's a place for me. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
I want you to just take that in for a minute. That the God of the universe who sent his son to die for you, who has already died for you, who has already died for you, has prepared a place at the table. Has prepared a place. There is a chair at the table in heaven with your name on it. And he wants you to be there. He wants you to join him. It says in the Word of God that the Son has set you free and that you are free indeed. Lord Jesus, in this moment, chains are broken. That there is freedom and he is calling you and calling you to that freedom. Don't deny that. We're going to sing this again. And when you say those words, I am chosen, not forsaken. God says, I am who God says I am. You got to believe that. You got to believe that you are worthy, that you are loved, and you got to feel that. You know, we can be a mouthpiece and say that we know how much God loves us, but until you know how much God loves you, you're not going to really get it. And so I want you to know that is important for me. I thank you, Jesus, that he loves every single one of you in here. And once you get it, it changes your life. It wrecks it. It shakes the very foundation that you're on. So we're going to sing this again. And we're going to lift our voices up to the heaven. I need for you to break the heavenly realms. Bust through the heavenly realms with your voices. Right now, just in one voice, we're going to do it. You ready? We're going to show Jesus that we just, woo, we love him and that he deserves all of our praise. Here we go.
I am chosen, not forsaken. I am who you say I am. You are for me, not against me. I am who you say I am.
Sing it again.
I am chosen.
Worship Jesus. I'm telling you, I don't know about y'all, but I get real excited.
I keep fighting voices in my mind that say I'm not enough.
I don't know about y'all, but I go through that.
Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just I'm falling short when I don't belong. believe. The only thing that matters now is everything you think of me.
Yes. Yes. Sing this with me.
In you I find my worth. In you I find my identity. Oh.
Sing this one loud right here.
You have every failure, God, and you'll have every victory.
I don't know how many of you actually believe that. And I pray that right now that you do, that just settles deep within you that God loves you. I'm telling you, it changes everything. It changes who you know, who you speak to, what you do with your life. It changes you. And so I want to do this chorus one more time with just voices. Again, we're going to do that. We're going to break the heavenly realms. We want angels dancing, right? We want Jesus to be up there like tap dancing, doing some Irish dance. I don't know what. But just because he hears the people that he loves the most, Jesus died for you. He died for you. And to understand the scope of that is just overwhelming. Overwhelming. That he loves you so much that he would die for you. You know, and so we're going to do this. We're going to do this one more time. You know, one, I want to leave you with this too before we go into our, we do this and we go into the third song and worship before Adam comes up. This year, my life verse has been Revelation 12:10, where it says that there are two ways that we defeat Satan. One is by the blood of the Lamb that has already been done for you. Jesus has died on Calvary. Don't leave him hanging on that cross. He has been there. He has done that. He has risen. He conquered death. We're not going to leave him there. But the second thing is the power of your testimony. The power of your testimony. There is no condemnation. There is no shame. There is no guilt in anything that we have all been through. Because what you have been through, what I have been through, what we have all experienced leads to redemption and to a testimony that then saves other people for the kingdom of God. And that is what we want. So anytime you feel like you shouldn't speak, that you shouldn't tell someone else what you have been through, you remember Revelation 12:10, that is the way that you defeat the enemy. That Jesus died, he shed that blood, and by the power of your testimony, when you feel like you shouldn't open your mouth, you be courageous and open your mouth. And you tell people what God has done for you. So we're going to sing this last chorus, and then we're going to go into our third song, and then I promise I'm going to stop. All righty, you ready? Here we go.
You say I am loved when I can't feel. say of me, oh, we believe.
Yes, Lord, thank you. Now we're just going to sing of the goodness of God.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Yes.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I love you, boy. You have led me through the fire. In my darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Yeah! 'Cause all my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yeah. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Sing it again. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. It's chasing you down. Your goodness is running after, it's running after. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. So my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God.
Thank you.
Father, we're grateful that you're running after us. I'm so glad, God, when the Spirit of God catches me. I'm so glad when I slow down long enough for you to catch me and take me to that peaceful place and that place of joy. We've all felt that almost in this room. Those times when we're still and feel the presence of God. I thank you so much for the church, for the people that have given their talent tonight and taken us into your very presence. And now as we continue to flow, God, we give you our hearts and we give you our ears tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Praise God.
Whew. Yeah, that was awesome. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. What a blessing, what a treat that you come and serve and lead us in worshiping the King tonight. So that's great. Hey, before I dive in, I kind of told a lot of you guys Monday, but today we officially announced our partnership with Williamson College and that they're going to offer course credit for every man that graduates our program. That's huge. Like, what? What? God, what are you doing? Like, how incredible. How much of a kick in the teeth is that to the enemy about the stigma of addiction, about all of these things? It's like, oh, hey, we're going to offer college credit if you are wanting to get your life back. I mean, gosh, it's chills. And I'm just in awe of how good God is. So, man, good stuff. I'm excited about this message tonight, so let me just pray and we'll dive in, okay? Father in heaven, God, I thank you so much for your love and your goodness as we just sang. God, I thank you for the opportunity to stand here and proclaim my testimony. By the blood of the Lamb and my testimony, God, we overcome the evil one. Father, I thank you for your truths. As we dive into the word that you left us, you've told us so many beautiful truths. God, help us to understand those and walk in those. God, I love you and I praise you, God, and I pray that you make little of me right now and more of you. In Jesus' name, amen. So the idea was reminded of this message. I had the opportunity to go and guest lecture at Williamson College last week or the week before, and the topic that I was given to lecture on was absolute truth versus moral relativism, so I ate that up. I love those kind of things. And so obviously I went in and I was talking about the absolute standard of truth, which is the Word of God, what He says is. And I was telling the class, man, I believe that the culture that we're in is at the place that it is because Christians stopped engaging culture. It became more about in here than out there. And part of that is I don't know, fear. There's a lot to that. But spawning into what I'm about to teach, it's like, do we not know what He has said? Do we not know what He has done? And so there's this fear of all of these different worldviews, and yet the Christian is afraid to stand on the Word of God and proclaim the truth, the absolute truth. And man, I think, I always get in trouble. I think that if we walked out as Christians and we began to speak our worldview and biblical truth and not be mean or anything, but just have love in our heart and say, hey, I'm not wavering from this. Yeah, you might disagree. That's okay, but this is the truth. And in fact, I'm not going to go into the whole lecture, but it's pretty good. it's really about how other worldviews crumble and they have to borrow from the Christian worldview just to make sense of their own worldview. It's pretty great, but if you look back throughout history, man, the church, capital C, the body of Christ, has always paved the way for arts, intellect, building things, and it's like, man, where have we gone? We're afraid to engage with culture. So that was what led me to this story, and I've told this story before, which made me want to talk about this tonight. A while back, my wife was somewhere, and I'd just put the kids down to bed. And I have a dog. And I think, like most people, whenever the doorbell rings, what does your dog do?
Bark.
Loudly. And again, I just put the kids to bed. And if you have two young kids and you're my age, that's a feat. I feel like I just ran the marathon in the Olympics, but they're in bed and finally it's quiet and I could sit down, and then all of a sudden, ding dong, my dog goes crazy. I'm losing. I open the door and it's two Mormon missionaries at like 7:30, something like that. And I'm like, shh, quieten down the dog. And I was like, hey, will you come back Wednesday? Will you come back Wednesday at 6 o'clock? And they're like, oh yeah, they're so sweet. Yeah, yeah. And so I really wanted them to come back, and I don't think they knew. Well, I know they didn't know that, you know, my degree's in religion, and I know quite a bit about the LDS church. And so they came back Wednesday and invited them in. My wife was there, kids were all just cutting up. And my wife sees that I'm about to engage in a long conversation. She goes, here he goes again. And so she took the kids upstairs, and I just began to talk with them and speak truth about some major conflicts in their belief in what the Word says. Things like us becoming gods, and the Word of God says, I am the Alpha and the Omega. There is no other God. I am one. And began to talk about these things, and at the end of the day, here's why I'm telling you the story. At the end of the day, I almost had to convert them to Mormonism in order for me to let them understand, hey, this is what you believe. Here's why it's dangerous. And it began to click, and it was a beautiful story, but that's not the point. The point was, tonight, I want to get back to the basics of what we believe. And I thought, kindred spirit, so much about what she was saying, Stacia was saying in the songs, do you know what we believe, Christian? If so, do you understand why? You understand the power in the Word? You understand the promises of God for those who believe? We make radical claims here at S2L. We are on the outskirts of the addiction recovery world. We don't say, hey, I didn't come out here and introduce myself as an addict. I'm a bloodstained child of the kingdom. I've been crucified with Christ. Glory. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Why would I say I'm an addict? You know how radical that is, how different it is. We don't tell you guys, as you know in classes, hey, it's a God of your understanding. If you just give it up to him, what? That's how I got here, doing things to my own understanding. In fact, the Bible says, lean not on your own understanding. So when we say these radical things, we want to point us to the Word of God. We want to talk about it. And so tonight, I'm going to break down probably a scripture that you guys have never heard before. Have y'all heard John 3:16? You have. You have. We're going to talk about John 3:16 because it's kind of like the pinnacle. It's one of the most powerful, popular scriptures on the planet, right? See it at football games. You know, a lot of you know it by heart. But do we know what it says, and do we know why? I'm going to break down the context of it leading up to it. I'm going to talk tonight, okay? So dive in, John 3, verses 1 through 15, and then we'll stop and talk. Now there was a man of the Pharisee named Nicodemus. Pharisees named Nicodemus. So Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. Nicodemus was a very religious man, okay? Very intelligent man, and you guys have heard me talk before. He was someone who would teach the Word of God. How did he teach it? Because he memorized the first five books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. That's, some of y'all are like, oh, what is John 3:16 again? It's like the second half of it we're forgetting. This man memorized the Word of God. Books. And he's about to engage in a question, a conversation with our Lord and Savior. Check this out. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher, that you are a teacher come from God. For no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. Jesus answered him, truly, truly, I say to you, Unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus said to him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? He didn't get it, did he? I mean, if and Jesus says, you're supposed to be the teacher. You don't understand what I'm saying? And they just asked a question like one of you guys. Hey, man, how am I going to be born again, man? I'm already born. He didn't get it. So Jesus is going to break it down. He says, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. Nicodemus said to him, how can these things be? He's still not getting it, right? So Jesus is about to lay something on him that's going to make it click. And I don't think you're going to catch it, but we're going to talk about it. How can these things be? Jesus answered him, are you the teacher of Israel and yet you do not understand these things? Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness to what we have seen, but you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you heavenly things? Here it is. No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. Now, has anybody, I mean, I'm hoping you guys, we're pleading with you guys to be in the Word, be in the Word, be in the Word. But have you ever read John 3? Obviously 3:16, you're like, oh yeah, got that one. I remember that one from vacation Bible school. But leading up to it, Jesus is talking about when Moses lifted up the serpent. What? What are you talking about? And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. So here's the context. This is why it's important, because Jesus gives him a nugget right here so he could fully understand what he's about to say in 16. The story that he's referring to is in Numbers chapter 21. And God had redeemed the Hebrews, the Israelites, from Egypt, like 400 something years of slavery. He redeemed them. They were in the wilderness. They were going to the promised land. And they were grumbling and complaining about how God was treating them, about what he was doing for them, or about what he wasn't doing for them. And I want you to understand how absurd that is. How absurd that is. And I've heard these things before, and I click back and forth. But here's a little way to understand. So Kevin, I pick on Kevin. Hello, Kevin. So Kevin finds himself arrested, and the bail's really high. And God just puts it on my heart to. I'm talking about really high. This is fictitious. Kevin's a man of God. But I go and I put a lien on my house to get this money to go bail Kevin out. Kevin gets in the car. We're driving. I'm just like, man, he's had a rough, however long, couple weeks. Hey, man, I'm going to get you some dinner. Let's pull into McDonald's. How absurd it is of the Israelites to be moaning and complaining to God would be like Kevin be like, McDonald's? Really, Adam? I thought we were closer than that. McDonald's, we can't go get a steak. You're going to take me to McDonald's right now? Like, that would be absurd, right? I'd probably be like, all right, let's go back. Let me get my money back. And then wouldn't that just be absurd? And so they're complaining and they're losing their focus on who God is and that he just saved them. And so God sent snakes to bite them. Isn't that wild? That'd get your attention, wouldn't it? And it got my attention. I don't like snakes. And so they would bite him. Some people died. And the story is this, to draw them back from their complaining that they need God. They need God. And so God instructed Moses to build this the serpent, the snake of bronze, and lift it up on this pole, And he told, if the people will look upon the snake and trust in God, I will heal them. It's a weird story, right? One that you maybe didn't catch in VBS. It's like, why in the world? But think of it, it's deeper than that, and I'm gonna break that down. He would have gotten it. Nicodemus would have been like, oh, the people were supposed to look at the very thing that was killing them. Focus on the very thing that is killing you and trust in God and I'll heal you. Isn't that a little bit of foreshadowing? Because how does he end in 15? He says what? Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. Well, what was it that's killing us that was placed on Jesus?
Sin.
Yeah. Sin. The wrath of God was poured out because of our sin. Not Jesus' sin. He was perfect. Like, I can't even fathom perfection. Like, not even a second of anything, of lust, not a second of unrighteous anger, not a second of anything. He was perfect. And our sin held him to the cross. And so Nicodemus is like, huh. He wouldn't know it fully until Jesus was crucified. But could you imagine? Can you see the foreshadowing? Can you see the beauty of this next passage? That if you look upon the cross, if you look upon the cross and you see what's holding Christ there and you trust in God, he'll save you. He'll save you. How do we know that? Because here's the most unpopular verse on the planet. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Let's get back to the basics. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. And it's this love that's so incredible. We're singing about the love of God, the goodness of God, how awesome God is. But here's something, and again, I'm gonna say some things that might sting later and you might not catch, but listen carefully. This love of God is not unconditional. Wait, what? Clearly, there's a condition there that whoever believes, right? So it's not without condition, but it is without distinction, isn't it? Doesn't matter what color you are. Doesn't matter about your past, that shame cloud that's lingering over you as you walked in here tonight. Doesn't matter how you came in here tonight. There's no distinction in the love of God. It's just the condition. Believe, you must be born again. The love of God. And whosoever does believe, he will not perish, but have eternal life. It's hard to grasp, isn't it? Now, if I'm gonna be consistent and I'm gonna say these things, the S2L is gonna say these things to you about there's freedom in Christ, there's freedom in Christ, there's freedom in Christ. You don't have to be defined by the things that you fell to. In fact, you could walk out of them. You can look. Paul says that I don't look at what's behind. I press on. You can be this new reborn, this new creation. If I'm going to say all those things, I've got to really tell you biblically what addiction is. Biblically, addiction is idolatry. Not adultery, idolatry. Here's a layman's or a maybe a Webster's. Idolatry is the worship of an object as God. Never thought about it that way, maybe. The worship of an object as God. And it was easy for me to relate because of the life that I lived that, okay, I could see that. I could see that, I worship money. I worshiped this drug that had its hooks in me. I did everything it told me to do. No matter who I hurt, no matter what I said, no matter what it cost. But you know what the reality was? It wasn't the money that I worshiped. It wasn't the drug that I worshiped, wasn't the drink that I worshiped, wasn't the porn that I worshiped. It wasn't any of those things that has its hooks in you. It was Adam Comer that I worshiped. It was me. Never real, and I say this so much, but I never thought that. I would never think that I'm God or worship myself. I would never even think that or say that, or even that never crossed the brain, but that's exactly what I was doing. I was the idol. I did whatever pleased me. Even when I had so much history that showed it always ended badly when I placed myself on that seat. Always. So much pain that I'd have to numb that pain. It would produce so much shame that I'd have to numb that shame. So much guilt, I'd have to numb that guilt. So many lies, I'd have to cover them up. It was just this rat race, man. It was idolatry. And so if we're going to tell you about the freedom and the beauty of God's promises, we got to tell you how to get in the fight. You got to know what you're fighting. When we talk about the armor of God, and you always hear me talk about, man, the things that you're fighting is not flesh and blood, but it's spiritual. You got to know what you need to fight. You got to know that, hey, the things that draw me away from God and they draw me to these things, that God sent his only son to die for. He died because I was an idolatrous man. Because I worshiped myself or these things, and Christ came and died for that sin. So until I could stop thinking that it's cute, until I could stop thinking that it's disgusting, I hate that I do this. I'm not talking about perfection. I am talking about progression, right? Progressively, I'm not going to do things perfect, but until I hate it, you're not going to know the fight you're in. I mean, I hear so often so many, oh man, how many rabbit trails do I have time for tonight? I hear so often so many silly justifications about what you guys are going to do when you leave here. Oh, I didn't have this problem. I could still do this. I could still do this. I could still do this. That wasn't me. It's like, wait a minute. What? Do you hear just the idolatry bell ringing? Ding, 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 ding. Why can you still, why are you wanting to do any of that? Why? Why is your mindset still on how you can still worship and serve and please you? It should put up a red flag. It says, be born again, repent. Crucify with Christ. It's no longer I who live. That's the message of the gospel. Come and die so that you may live. What are you dying to? You're dying to just the idolatry. You're dying to anything that tries to elevate you above God. You're dying to things that hurt the heart of God, that he sent his son to die for. You're dying to those things. Those are of this world, not of the kingdom of God. And you're supposed to be a bloodstained child of the kingdom. Long for the things that please God. Long for those things. Let me read something that I got from about idolatry and about addiction that I got from, I think, Desiring God or something like that. Excuse me. Idolatry captures how human beings both purposefully indulge their desires. We worship idols because we think they will satisfy us. And we are dominated by those desires. I'll stop there. I don't speak to you. I don't teach about addiction to you because I've read it in a book. Okay? I have read a lot of books about addiction and things like that. But I genuinely speak to you, the next things I'm about to say, because I lived that life. I lost everything. Everything. Because of addiction. God restored that. But if you've never battled an addiction, I can't put to words tonight for you to understand that desire when you're in full-blown addiction. I just can't. I'm not even going to attempt it. I can't give explanations because it seems crazy. The things that we would do because of that desire that controls us. It's strong. That idolatry will hook you. But here's another truth. The curriculum that we teach from 2 Peter, what does it say? You can escape the corruption that is in the world that's brought on by sinful desires. That's a mic drop. Did you hear the promise? Did you hear it? You can escape the corruption of this world, of the stuff that's trying to kill you and take your family from you that Christ died for. You can escape that and the desires.
Amen.
Mic drop. Let's go home. Do you believe that, Christian? If you are born again, that's a promise of God. And then it lists those seven things that we just try and instill into your heart. It's growth. It's growth. I want to be more like him. I want to be more like him. Do you believe that? Like, really? Let's draw the line in the sand. Like, here's the deal. We're not this. I got to be careful.
Come on,
this isn't a game to us. Like, I'm not up here. The staff isn't talking to you about these things. This is really what we believe because it is the absolute truth.
Amen.
Now, if you could begin to believe it and walk in it, then you'll start to also believe some of the other things that seem so counterculture, but also so counter you. Why is that important? Because I was worshiping me. And if it's telling me to do these things, that stings, man. I don't want to do that. I don't want to. It's colliding. And if you could lay it down, if you can come and die so that you may live, it is so beautiful. It is. The next part is just inside of the addiction and the idolatry, I just became a liar. A liar. Sound familiar? I would lie when it was easier to tell the truth. That's just who I was. It's who I was. Now, why does that happen, do you think, in addiction and idolatry? Because eventually you're lying to yourself. Think about it. No one's lied to you more than you. You're lying to yourself that this fix is actually the real fix because you know it's a fraud. You know it's a cheap substitute for the glory and the promises of God. How do you know that? Because you have history that shows you. I've done it. I've got to do it again. Got to do it again. Fleeing, pain, suffering, all of the things that it brings. You know it is, and you lie. Check this out. Idolatry opens our eyes to the hidden alliance with addiction. We're either linked to God or we forge an alliance with an anti-God and his crumbling empire. One of the expressions of the alliance to idolatry is lying. Check out the scripture that reveals the roots of these lies. John 8:44. When he, Satan, lies, he speaks out of his own character. For he is a liar and the father of lies. Interesting, right? He speaks out of his own character. He's the father of lies. Why? Because number two that I dealt with so bad inside of this was shame. Was shame. And I don't speak of this very lightly. Because I've done this for so many years. I've had things myself in my personal life happen, but I've done this for so many years to know that a lot of times, man, the shame that you're numbing later in life was done to you by someone that was supposed to protect you. It's not an excuse, it's reality. And it became your source. So I don't say that lightly, but I still say with boldness that even if that was your story, you're still choosing a cheap substitute over the glory of God and his promises. He despises shame. Some of you have heard me say this before, but inside of this liar, idolater, shame-filled, guilt-filled, dirty feeling, in the darkest season of my entire life, this God whispered, I love you. I love you, Adam Comer. But God, you know, I know you see this. I know that you see everything about me. I maybe was good at hiding and manipulating to others, and I could wear a really pretty mask at times, but God, I know that you see through that, and you love me. For God so loved me that he sent his son to die. You understand that on the cross of Christ, he became our sin for us. For our sake, he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. That's the gospel, man. So on the cross, Jesus Christ, he became a liar and a thief and a manipulator. And all of those wicked things I did, he became that. And guess what? So that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So you put your faith in that cross that's lifted up, just like the serpent was lifted up, and you see the thing that's killing you on Christ, and you say, I love you. I repent. I trust you. His righteousness, his perfection is now yours. And so here's the beauty of that, the beauty of the gospel. God doesn't see you sitting here tonight. If you are a born-again believer, he doesn't see you tonight as the addict or whatever label someone wants to put or you want to put on yourself. He sees you as perfect, spotless, blameless, the righteousness of God. You know why that's important? Because of the gospel, man. You're free. Who the Son sets free. It's free indeed. That's power. It's power. Do you believe these things? Back to the basics, man. John 3:16. He gave his son to die. You know how important that is? 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, and behold, the new has come. That's like the, I have that on a poster in my garage, man. At every Christ-centered recovery facility on the planet, it's going to be somewhere. The truth of this scripture, the power of the scripture. But here's the message to you. If you are new tonight, I'm going to have a time to respond and those kind of things. If you are new, if you're a new creation, you've got to convince yourself to stop acting like the old. Amen. It's just trying to kill you. Celebrate that tonight. So you guys, please come back up. Christians, this is what you believe biblically. You believe who the Son sets free is free indeed, because we read that in John. We sing it because we read it in John. We believe that if you're in Christ, you're a new creation, that the old has passed away. He's dead. He's dead. He's buried. And the new has come. We believe that. So the call to respond tonight is two things. One, man, if you're not a born-again believer, if you haven't walked with Christ, if you haven't had that love and that conversation with Christ about surrendering everything to him and laying your will down and asking his will to take over, if you haven't done that, man, please, do that. That's eternal. All the awesome things that we're talking about, the college and the just the cool things that God's allowing us to see and do, man, those will fade away. But not this eternal decision to walk with Christ. If that's you, man, we have staff here that would, they'll spread out. They would love to speak with you about that. You know why? Because they could reach out and call you brother. Because they were too adopted into Christ's family, to God's family. They too have tasted this freedom. If you are a believer, I think tonight, during this song, during this time of response, you just, God, help me to know the love that you have for me as a believer. God, break me. Break me. I want to know you more. I want to trust what you say over what I think. I want to trust what you say over my own understanding. God, I believe. Help me in my unbelief. When you say that there's freedom, God, I want to taste it. Repent. God, I'm sorry that I served cheap substitutes for so long. And I exchanged your glory and your promises for them because I thought they were better. I'm sorry. That's your response tonight, I think. That's my response tonight. So if the staff, if you guys would spread out to the sides, anybody that's here, staff or whatever, you want to talk with them, please do. But I would just encourage you, move tonight. There's power in movement. As they play this song over us, repent. Come to know the Lord. He's calling you tonight. If you don't know him, salvation is today. He's calling you. How do I know that? Because his word's gone out. The places and boundaries of time have been ordained that you're in these seats, hearing this message of back to the basics. Let's respond tonight.
I was so affected by that. Thank you so much. Just straight from the Holy Spirit. But my father was an alcoholic, and I grew up in that cycle of living with a parent who had an addiction. And when Jesus took my daddy, I fell into the cycle of food addiction. And when I moved to Nashville almost 10 years ago, I was 436 pounds, completely broken. Missing my daddy, just all of these things. And, you know, it was once told me that my pursuit of music was God's pursuit of me. And I know that now because I'm going to tell you that the only way that we fight the battle that we're in is through the Word of God. It's the only way. If I had not gotten to know the Word of God and how much He loved me, I would not be standing here. I would not understand that my father, he didn't understand how much God loved him. And in turn, I didn't understand that either because I felt unworthy. But you are not. This is the way that we fight. Right here. It doesn't matter what you're surrounded with. It doesn't matter if it's pain, anxiety, fear. These are lies of Satan. You're really surrounded by God, and that's what we're going to sing right now. Before we go back into talking about the goodness of God, this is how you fight your battle. The angels are suiting up in the locker room. Right? They're ready to head out on the battlefield. Don't leave them in the locker room. Help them fight the battle. It's already won. And that was incredibly powerful. It's how I fight my battle. Just sing that.
This is how I fight my battles, the Word of God. This is how I fight my battles. You may look like you're surrounded, but you're surrounded by God. It may look like you're surrounded, but you're surrounded by God. No more pain or fear, anxiety. You may look like you're surrounded, but you're surrounded by God. I may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. 'Cause this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. On your knees. This is how I fight my battles. At the feet of Jesus. This is how I fight my battles. You may look like you're surrounded, but you're surrounded by God. Sing that. I may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Sing that to Him. I may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. I may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Lord, we're just going to sing to the goodness of God tonight. That's how we're going to end this. Because it does not matter what we have been through. God takes good, bad, and makes good. He takes the bad and He makes the good. Everything is for His good. We may not understand it in the time that it happens, but it's always, always for His good.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful,
even when it didn't seem like it.
And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, we love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In my darkest nights, you were close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. Yeah. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, oh Lord, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yeah. It's running after me. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after. It's running after me.
Say it again.
Your goodness is running after. It's running after. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down and surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I'm gonna sing of the goodness of God. Yeah.
Would you guys just put your hands up? Let me pray. Just put your hands up. Who cares? Who cares? Father in heaven, you are good. You're so good. God, I pray that tonight people in this room are hearing you whisper, I love you. You're so good, God, that you sent your son to pay for my stuff. God, I pray that we are bold as we walk out and we engage the culture with people and stand on your word because of how beautiful it is because of your promises. God, protect us, protect our hearts and our minds as we walk out of here. And God, I pray that we become bold. I love you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hey, let's give them a